And good morning, everyone. And thank you, Dennis. This is great. Definitely great. So I'll just introduce myself quickly. I'm Sean Shawnham. I'm the chair of this part meeting. I'm just going to go further through the housekeeping. ACC, so if you have ACC, there was an assigned quiet room for the day, which is in the boardroom. We've also got 2,000 personal assistants from independent living alternatives on AIM, and they'll be wearing high-vis vests, so you can identify them. If you have any questions related to access, please go to the signing in table, and there'll be someone there who will be able to assist you with that. There will be photos filming and live streaming going on. The workshops being live streamed will be the independent living and the persons that are connected to the workshop. If people don't want to photograph our film, could you please make some notes to Chris, the photographer, and over the live streamer. Okay, just want to briefly outline the aims of today, which are really today is coming together of the Disabled Trade Unions, DPO, and grassroots. And really, we're trying to get together to, if you like, to bring all our resources together, all our experiences of years and years of abuse by government, by institutions, and hopefully stop at the moment we're fighting the same battles separately, and hopefully we can come together as a cohesive group and feel we'll be far better served to fight this extremely business government. So I'll just go on to my speech now. Going for a seat to start now. Sorry about that, Andrew. Okay. Hello, comrades and friends. I'm Sean McGovern. I'm TEC's General Counsel, Disability Counsellor. I welcome you all to this National Disabled Persons People's Summit. 9 years ago, as a result of an under-regulated banking sector, we watched as our economy began to disintegrate. Although mega banks and subprime lenders were responsible for the meltdown of the economy, it was the public services that was presented with a bill. For deaf and disabled people, this meant our social security to be savagely attacked. We were stripped of the very benefits that allow us to live, and are being denied services essential to our independence and well-being. Yet, comrades, deaf and disabled people have not sat back and accepted this treatment passively. No, we have faced up to the brutal regime that will push us back into the shadow of isolation and imprison us in the cells of our own helplessness. Groups such as Deepak, Black Triangle, and DPO have taken the fight to this story as predecessor coalition government. Grassroots people alongside trade unions have joined in together in common cause. It was Deepak and others who forced Atos to abandon the work ethical assessment contract. We've had these successes with government use only and continuing to fund ILF payments to council until 2020. We're winning a high percentage of the bills being formally assessed for capability assessment and PIP assessments. And let's not forget the report that Rothfuss submitted to the UN that exposes government for failing disabled people in the UK. Comrades, disability politics has hit the mainstream. So today we're hoping that by bringing together deaf and disabled people from the trade union movement, deaf and disabled people's organisations, and grassroots campaigns, we can find ways to better pool our knowledge and experiences in an attempt to more effectively coordinate our resistance and organise joint campaigning in identified areas. Aside from the keynote speakers this morning, the remainder of the day will focus on workshops, the idea that each workshop will bring together, will work together towards the beginning of campaign day, they can do quite actions that can affect real change. Solidarity, comrades. The next speaker is not here in person, but he's a motion speaker, John McDonald. So,
I want to say my solidarity and greetings to today's conference. It's important people are coming together now to look at how we campaign around the issues of disability in the coming period. It's important because so many people are suffering as a result of 7 years of hard austerity. And we have to remember that the Tories took a specific decision that they were going to target disabled people for their cuts. They thought that disabled people were vulnerable and therefore would not fight back. And that's why they blamed them. You know, the burden of much of your strength is onto disabled people themselves. We've got to show them that we're not going to take it anymore. I want to pay tribute to all those who've been campaigning over the recent years. I've been on demonstrations and occupations, we've had public meetings and rallies, and disabled people have thrown themselves into the campaign in this austerity. I want to thank everyone. I want to thank disabled people against the cuts. I want to thank the CUC Disability Group, all the individual unions, all those individual campaigns that have been campaigning on issues like work capability assessment, the brutality of the social security system, the way in which the health service and education and other aspects of our welfare state have been cut, targeted against disabled people. This government is brutal, absolutely brutal. It targeted disabled people and it caused real suffering. As many of our comrades would know, we've not survived either. And the number of suicides associated with the social security cuts and the sanctions of the WCA implementation. The 2,300 people, just that's, I think, a very conservative and small seat estimate, of those people who were assessed as ready for work and yet died before they could take that work. It's been a scandal, an absolute scandal what this government's done to say. That's why it's right that we come together now and talk about the next wave of our campaign. I think what we've got to do is explain in every aspect of life what this government has done to the disabled people. What they've done in terms of withdrawing benefits, basically, just the basic income to tackle and deal with the basic needs that disabled people have got. What they've done in terms of withdrawal of care. We now know 1 million people no longer receive the care that they need as a result of the cuts and the austerity measures. But also the denying of the health treatments that people need, the long waiting lists for essential operations and treatment. Yes, and also the cutbacks that are taking place in education. You know, special needs pupils are now coming under particular attack by this government, services are closed down, and support for them is being undertaken, denying many disabled young people the opportunities of living a full and fruitful life as a result of that. I think we've got to expose all that's going on. All the reports that we do, make sure they're published and publicised. Make sure that the research that we do is out there so that no one should ever really say they don't know about what's happened to disabled people in this country. But yes, also, it's not just getting information out there, is it? It's about mobilising. It's about demonstrating. It's about making sure we're campaigning in elections to support candidates who support disabled people. And it's taking direct action whenever we possibly can where we feel outraged at the cuts and levels of austerity that this government is implementing. So I welcome the conference today. I welcome what you're doing in terms of planning the next Labour campaign. And you can rest assured that you have my support and you have the Labour Party. But also, you can also rest assured that when we go into government, whenever this government falls, it will be you that will be determining our policy. It will be you that will be involved in implementing it, because we believe that principle for disabled people. Nothing about us without us. You will go into government just as much as when you're in that election comes. Solidarity.
Okay, this speaker is Bob Williams Finley. Bob has been around the city for obviously himself a long, long time. He's been a campaigner. He's been an intellectual band, only intellectuals and movement. So without further words from me, Bob. Thank you.
Today, I'm considering a certain part of a disabled movement, catching upon contradiction and tension, myths and realities, and their implications for today's activists. Marcus Garvey said, people without the knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots. Disabled people have only been denied knowledge of their histories or been fed distorted versions. Otherwise, we run the risk of trying to reinvent the wheel or repeating past mistakes. Since the Victorian era, disabled and deaf workers have self-organized, but the modern disabled people movement has a different history and sets of my starting point is acknowledging the political awakening to same person of 1970 was seeing a vastly different world to the politically conscious person living in the age of austerity. This is because the experience of the disabled moment is specific to a historical moment in time. The 1960s and 70s saw an upsurge in radicalism with the revitalization of the women movement and the emergence of other movements such as the for civil rights, against the war in Vietnam, and the gay and lesbian movement, all of which have provided the space for disabled people to self-organize. Many young disabled people and ex-servicemen in Britain were influenced by these events and started to question their location within society. The Union of Physically Impaired Against Segregation was founded in 1972. Paul Hunt wrote a letter to the Guardian inviting other disabled people to join a fight against disability of boredom. If partner Juliet explained, you Paris expert disability as an oppressive relationship and power relationship of control. Our movement was, and maybe still is, a social movement. These are any broad-based social alliances connected through their shared interest in blocking or affecting social change. As I have to be formally organised, multiple alliances may work separately from a common cause, and still be considered a from Britain. What was and remains disabled people so interested? I would say fundamentally two things. Make it a challenge to have society see disability and therefore treat disabled people, and seeking to overthrow the condition whereby disabled people find themselves excluded from or marred out within mainstream society. These are at the heart of our movement, and they are broad enough to allow conservative thinking disabled activists like Stephen Bradshaw to work with revolutionaries like myself. And that's the book. Both of the aims have been open to interpretation and analysis. You publish after the definition of disability, which will have been in position of certain restriction, or by the failure of the organisation of society to take our impairment into account. This challenges the view that disability is a biologically determined condition measured by functional loss. Talking about the failure of society to take our impairment into account, at best, describe what has happened to us. Your pious definition leaves out, in my opinion, a viable aim. Surely, it is precisely how society tries to take us into account, only devaluing us, that ultimately leads us not being taken or included in the social organisation of society. Like this subject to be discussed in Britain today is the nature of capitalism. No one talks about capitalism. What it is, how it impacts. My point of individual disability gives an insight into how, from birth of capitalism, our society value people with impairment via ideas associated with individualism and humanity. Our movement has neglected this modern insight by focusing only on its very simple model of disability. I put it to you today that it never been about ignorance or forgetting we exist. Like racism and sexism, disability stems from ideology and practice would prop up the capitalist system. Disabled people show the oppression results of our relations with the rest of society. In simple terms, we want to be included in structures, system and practice which are mainly broadcast that have no desire whatsoever when they're pushed to accommodate a different threatened the status quo. Our movement is confronted by huge contradictions. We want to end our oppression by entering a society, creating rights that reject us in return. Historically, two approaches have been used to address this contradiction. Seek improvement within the system versus seeking to transform it. A 70 for the emerging the disabled income group, which advocated better benefit. And I said it was challenged by the pious who saw disability as a liberation tool. The anti-witness are proliferation of self-organized groups of disabled people seeking to take control of their lives. The British Council Organization was established in 1981 and had 9 members in November 82. Local coalition emerged in the first half of the 80s, but by mid-90s, we CLDP had 122 members. VCLDP was an all-night call at the heart of our movement. We need, however, to strip back the mythology and look at where things were at back then. At the first National Committee meeting of British MVP, they agreed a national plan. Wait for it. Tackle specific social barriers to our integration into the community. Was that pleasing enough? You can decide. My point is that what we are seeing is that they talk about our housing needs and growing up plans. We will achieve our full integration, our education needs. We will reduce by half the number of disabled children going to special schools within a decade, and establishing nationwide Centre for Independent Living. Just over a decade later, many of the founders of our movement questioned how we ended up just campaigning around anti-discrimination legislation. And Rick Finkelstein, one of the key founders, very critical of this mind's approach, because he argued in terms of legislation, the mind's approach is about individual or named groups of people. The focus is on identified characteristics of the individual rather than the nature of kind, which is at the heart of the social model, and then making selected concessions based on how they define who is disabled. Now, people argue that the DDL was a bit good for the same people, yet all the evidence suggested from a different story. So how have we got here? And I think we need to look at how many of the organisations got sucked into this market economy around delivering services, which moves them away from the original idea of the social model. And Vic, in 1991, questioned whether the social model as it was in the 80s still applied in neoliberal Britain, or whether the market economy, direct payment, and the issue had actually taken it away from understanding that social approach, because she got isolated from each other. And of course, since 2010, we've been involved in a resistance struggle against austerity, led by disabled people against cuts at the forefront of this resistance. Deep cuts built upon the direct action staff campaigning from the 90s, used by the campaign for accessible transport and consolidated by the Great Action Network. I know I'm painting a rather gloomy picture, but I'm only doing it to help remind us that our roots are in an emancipation struggle, and by organising, educating and campaigning are essential to this. Our ultimate goal has to be social change. Personally, I will go further and say it requires a complete transformation exercise. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. You know, the painter's two sides. Your side of the painter's is important as the other side. And next speaker is Ellen Clifford. I think I know it's not. Thompson Strategy Manager, Anchorage in London, amongst no more things. Ellen, over to you.
I think before I say what I'm about to say, I should say I'm here in my disabled people against cuts capacity today. I'm really happy to be here today. You're in a room with around 200 deaf and disabled people who've travelled to London and given over your Saturday to planning how we can better fight the Tories and bring an end to austerity. And I think after a year like we've just had, a day like today is really welcome. A few weeks ago at the Stand Up to Racism conference, Sam on your feet spoke and she talked about the value in coming together. She spoke about the value in coming together with like-minded people for, in her words, nourishment. And she's really right, I think, that to achieve change, we can't only speak to the already converted, but we also need spaces where we can come together to debate and discuss, but also to support one another and affirm our shared understanding of what it is to fight and for and why. In some ways, it's been an interesting year. Labour didn't win the general election, but the food voting proof of what disabled people have known for many years now, and that's how big the opposition to austerity is and how big is the appetite for real change. Meanwhile, Tories have been imploding over Brexit and tearing strips off each other, with the recent debt scandals the latest sign of a government that is utterly weak and divided. The past year has also been difficult and distressing on new levels. Globally, the rise of the far right is a danger that disabled people understand only too well. And while we've been campaigning against austerity and the repression of debt and disabled people's rights, it's also been important to stand in solidarity against the scapegoating of refugees and migrants and to actively oppose racism and Islamophobia in our communities. After 7 years of austerity, the cuts are biting harder than ever, and it's difficult not to drown in the level of unmet need that is increasingly swamping our communities. The team at DPAC receive messages on a daily basis from people who are suicidal because of the cuts to their benefits or their social care support. And I know everyone campaigning in this area experiences the same thing every week. Deaf and disabled people's organisations are overwhelmed by demand for support, but they're not funded to provide, and with nowhere to signpost people to, because the support services that people need just don't exist anymore. The rollout of universal credit is causing even more devastation. Social care is being cut to the bone, leaving individuals trapped at home without access to toilets, to food or water for hours on end. Our mental health support services are being closed at a time of rocketing need. This year we also have a terrible tragedy at Grenfell Tower, where a number of deaf and disabled people lived, a horrific example of how cuts can kill. And then at a personal level, within the Disabled People's Rights Movement, we lost a number of our dear friends and inspirational activists. It's nearly a year since Deb Johnny, one of the co-founders of DPAC, passed away, a hole still keenly felt, and I'm going to try that. But we also, unexpectedly and tragically, lost Eleanor Thurman and Sophie Partridge, and from Mental Health Resistance Network, Robert Deller. I'd like to pay tribute to their lives and to the fight against injustice which was the way to the campaigning. The 2017 Labour Manifesto was put together with an unprecedented input from grassroots deaf and disabled campaigners, and it makes some important pledges. But the fact is, we can't wait until 2022 for the Labour government to be elected, because there's simply too much at stake here and now. And now is the time we need to up the pressure while the Tories are as weak as they are. We need to build our alliances and our resistance, to bring all people into political activity, because it's through collective organisation that we can win. I always remember going to speak at a Unite conference a few years ago, to speak on the same platform as Kate Green, who was then Shadow Minister for Disabled People, who refused to pledge Labour's opposition to the closure of the Independent Living Fund. The audience was a sea of yellow Save the ILF t-shirts, and yet I don't think a single person in the audience was an ILF recipient. In a meeting with Kate Green and Rachel Rudsaker, Sean here raised the issue of the ILF, to which Kate asked, how come there's so much fuss about something that would only affect 1,600 people? Sean replied, it's called solidarity, Kate. One of the building blocks is socialism. Solidarity can be a very powerful thing. Deaf and disabled people are used to being at the sharp end of dividing all tactics of the ruling class. We've experienced it through the scapegoating of benefit claimants and the resulting rise in hostile attitudes towards deaf and disabled people. But we've also experienced attempts to divide us between different impairment groups. This is how the government's tried to sell the accessible work cap to us, telling us that cutting support for deaf ESL users will free up money for more people with mental health support needs. But we haven't let ourselves be divided. On BBC last week, deaf and disabled campaigners from the Stop Changes to Access to Work campaign stood together and say all the more cuts for access to work abroad. There's enough for all our support needs to be met. The Stop Changes campaign brings together deaf and disabled people, but also BSL interpreters. The campaign hasn't let the government tell us the BSL interpreters pay too much, and it's therefore people fell to being cut. Deaf and disabled people have supported the development of the National Union of British Sign Language Interpreters and gone on their protests. And I'd like to congratulate NAVSU on their victory this year against Language Line, an agency that was trying to cut interpreters' fees by one third, proving that freelance workers can organise and win. After the UN signed last year that the UK government is guilty of grave and systematic violations of disabled people's rights due to welfare reforms, the government went into the routine examination under the Convention for the Rights of Persons with Disabilities that took place this year, with a view to securing a more positive appraisal of their record on disability. Throughout the process, they referred to themselves as world leaders on disability. They sent an extensive delegation of government officials from different departments to Geneva, where the examination was taking place. The grassroots deaf and disabled people had to work extremely hard. First of all, to make sure we were able to report directly to the committee without our views and experiences being watered down by people with other agendas. Then to make sure that the UK-wide delegation of the deaf and disabled people's organisations who went to Geneva were presenting a united message. And working together to help the Disability Committee members see behind the smoke and mirrors that the government representatives were spinning. The outcome was a damning report and public statement from the UN Disability Committee that never in its history has there been so worried about the country as they are about the UK today. Ultimately, that report has no teeth and its recommendations are unenforceable in UK or EU law, but it did shame the government. And the experience shows how effective deaf and disabled people can be when we work together and that we are not to be underestimated. Sadly, there's no quick fix to the issues that we face. History taught us that power never seems without demand. Taking legal challenges, getting stories in the media, using the United Nations are all useful tools for exerting pressure on the Tories and building our movement, but alone, none of that would be enough. We need to get rid of the Tories, not in 5 years, but now. We need to take every opportunity to amplify the Tories' crisis, fight every attack, build resistance, strike them out and get calling in. But even that won't be enough. The very nature of deaf and disabled people's oppression, as Bob explained, is intrinsically linked to capitalism. And in order to achieve a very inclusive society, where each person is valued for their individual worth rather than their ability to produce profit, we need to take down the stance of greatest system and its capitalism. I believe we have the power to do that, and we can win, but it won't happen overnight. So today I look forward to a day of taking nourishment from each other, to building and to organising. And so to give us up for the day ahead, I'm going to hand over to the formidable Peters.
Now we're going to be actually going through individual workshops now, so hopefully we'll have fun. Okay.